Bob, how old were you when you first went down the pit?
14, straight from school.
And what was the worst job you think you ever did?
The worst?
Yes.
Tramming, I think that was my worst job.
And what was tramming?
It was, you had to push the tub about 500 or 600 yards for the men to fill, and then fetch the empty tub out, the full tub out.
And this was as a boy, was it?
Well, no, that was when I was 16. As a boy, I was a pony driver. Mm. And you drifted from pony driving higher up the scale, tramming, coaling and so on. Well, I reckon through my life that tramming was the hardest job I ever had.
Tramming, you would agree with that, would you, Joe?
Oh, yes, absolutely. We started straight from the school, 14-year-old, and we started filling and tramming. Looked slightly different from Bob because we had to assist the coaler at the face to get the coal and fill the tub and then tram it. And it was a job completely out of hell for a young lad leaving the school.
Well, how old were you when you actually went down the pit? Do you remember your first day down there?
Oh, yes, you never forget those days. We got our job at the school gate. The colliers in those days were always clamouring for young lads at 14-year-old, purely and simply because of the fact that they could only pay them a very, very low wage. They couldn't even employ a lad in Scotland at 16 on the tramming because they'd had to give a bit more money. So the colliers were always at the school gates every holiday. And I got my job with an old, grand old fella called Andrew Livingston at the school gate, actually. And that was on the Friday. And Christmas Day was on the Monday, and I started on the day shift on Christmas Day on the Monday.
And what did you think when you first got down the mine, when your first day as a lad?
Well, you know, I come from a mining family. My father was a miner, my brothers were miners. We lived in a small mining town of about 5,000 or 6,000 people. And, you know, you were, at that time, you were enthusiastic. You know, going out that morning, you were full of enthusiasm. Everything was going to be new. But in a matter of 8 hours, of course, the whole world had changed. And you had worked a shift, you had filled, and that first day we filled about 18 tubs, which was around about 8 ton of coal. It was a very bad day, actually. But to me, of course, it was as if the end of the world had come. Every bone in my body was sore, my back was raw. And you never forget those days. We got home, no baths, of course, and you got home. You bathed at home, and my mother, when I came out of the bath and came through, my mother had my dinner on the table ready. And of course, fair proud of the youngest son going into the pit and earning money, which was desperately needed in the family. And she says, come on now, son, here's your dinner. But I was so exhausted and so sore that I told her, I says, well, if you can put it in the oven, Mum, I'll have a couple of hours sleep. I went to bed. I woke up the next morning at 4:45 to put my pit clothes on again and go back to the pit. That was my first day experience. I thought the whole world had tumbled round about me.
Bob, you talk about this tramming and you talk about the soreness. You've got marks this day, haven't you?
Yes, you see, it was so low that if your back got up like a camel a bit, a piece of skin off and all that used to stick to your shirt, yeah, and pull out.
Mick come on once with every one of his knuckles.
Knocked off.
All, nothing on him, all raw. Every one of his bones from his back. He was on a 2-foot seam or something, he come on and tell me, mm-hmm. Something. And going through, he took all the knuckles off his bones of his back.
What was the attitude to this, though, by sort of the medical officers that you had? I mean, if you had
Well, you didn't go to medical officers with a little bit of skin off your back.
No.
That had to be tested. At home, they used to get iodine bottle on, tap, tap, tap on it. Mm. And that wasn't very good as well. But you didn't go to ambulance home with a little bit of a knock like that.
Do you think then they were a bit callous, Joe, towards accidents and...?
The only ambulance facilities you had in those days was... part provided by the old coroners, who must have been the most callous and despicable body of Britishers ever were born, actually. And your main assistance in those days was voluntary assistance from the miners themselves. They used to form their own ambulance units, unpaid, and you had your own ambulance team. I myself was a member of the ambulance team, and well, I've been practically in this type of work all my life. And underground, as far as accident was concerned, the people these days would not believe such things could ever happen within the lifetime of persons like us.
Can you give us an example, then, of how callous they were?
Well, I got my first view of this when I was about 9 years old. I was down to the cooperative to get some messages, as we called it in Scotland, groceries and such, from my mother. And I came out of the cooperative, and it would be about 3:30 in the afternoon. And there was about a dozen miners coming down, all in the pit black, pushing a handcart, all round about this handcart. I'd never seen this before, and I stood there and watched it as it passed. And there was a dead miner on the handcart, with a brackish cloth over the top of him, and his leg was dangling, black leg was dangling over the end of the handcart. This was them taking a dead miner home. There weren't a coal owner representative there, there was nobody. There was the miners themselves taking one of their own comrades home.
Bob, you worked, you know, for some time in the coal face itself.
Yeah.
Now, we saw in that film the toughness, the conditions and everything. What was it like when you first used a pick, for example, which I saw that man doing it?
Well, you had no training in those days to go into the coal face. You went from tramming straight into the coal. And you'd swing that pick for about, we'll say, 7 hours. And it used to hurt your hands and rub them raw. And I said to my mate, an older man, I said, I can't carry my hands out. I said, well, it's terrible, all bleeding. He says, that knows what to do, don't they? I said, well, good piss on them. Well, I did, and believe me, it stung, but it took a lot of the pain out.
Yeah. Would you believe that, Edna?
Yes, I do believe it, because Mick's done it.
My husband's
done it, yeah. Washed his hands in chamber before he's gone to work after he's had it. Well, breakfast, I didn't used to have a bit of any breakfast, I'd have perhaps a bit of jam and a cup of tea off the go. Mm. But he always did his hands in pot before he went to work. Mm. And it hardened them, stopped them from blistering.
Yeah. Well, the conditions were pretty grim then, were they, Joe, in the mines in those days? They were a pretty tough job.
Very, very grim indeed. I was only 4 years in the pit when at the quarry I worked in, there was a disaster. And there was 11 of our men killed. To show you the division that existed, I mean, men at that time, for a long, long time, the men used to say, when you asked them how many men was killed in this disaster, the men used to say, and I was one of them, there were 10 men and an overman killed. Because there was a difference between the gaffers and the men. There was a brutality went on at those days, not practised by every official. There was some good lads and all, but the vast majority of them under the direction of the coal board were real brutes. Mm. And I can remember when we were tramming, the job that Bob was talking about, and of course, your body was so far torn and exerted at this job, so strenuously, so strenuous was the work. You were always soaked with sweat, and of course, as young lads, you naturally broke out in boils. And I had at this time boils right round the back of my neck. And we were tramming this day in this low road, and I happened to come up a bit too quick, and from one of the straps or bars on the top of the holding the roof up, I hit the back of my neck and knocked the top of two big boils. When I got in with the tub to the plate where we turned the tub, the overman was standing there, a fellow called Charlie Muir, who incidentally was one of the apostles of the church. He was the head elder of the local church and a very respected figure in the village. And I said to him, Charlie, I says, you got a bandage? He says, yes, son. He says, what do you want it for? I says, I've knocked a couple of heads off of boils, I says. And of course, the blood in the pus was running round my neck. And I says, give us a bandage. He says, boils? He says, there's no bandages for boils, he says. And I never got a bandage.
Edna, that was the man's side of it. That was the man's work. Did you, as a woman, a wife of mine, ever think about the danger that he was in daily?
Well, you thought about the danger from him going out to coming back, didn't you? You'd see him go out to work and they'd wave cheerio. You didn't know whether they were coming back or not. It was a really... It was right from him going out at door to seeing him come back in. I remember there was a bit when Bentley Colliery went up, the morning Bentley Colliery went up, and there was snow on the ground, and Mick were a bit late coming home. And I thought, oh dear, what's going on? And then they got it all around. All Bentley Colliery's gone up. A relation of mine, sister, all come up. Bentley Pitt's gone up, and there's about 50 killed. I says, oh God, I says, me can't come home yet, and he were on night, see? So my sister says to me, oh, she says, it's not our pit. She says, we'll have to get ready and go down and see if it is, if they're telling us the truth. Well, when it come to this young woman as a came, sister-in-law of mine as came, her husband's brother was killed in that explosion. And he's still in there. He's still encased in that pit. And that was in 1932. And he was only about 22. He'd just bought his own house down on the race course.
You don't forget things like that, do you?
You don't think, no. And then when we got settled over it, see, a couple of days after they said when they was going to be buried. Well, we were all like one big family. And there was about 30 of us walked it to Bentley, from Edlington to Bentley. And it would be about probably 12 miles. And we set off that morning in the fog and cold and walked it to watch them men. We was there about 9:30 and it was 20 minutes to 10 at night when we got back, watching them men being buried. Yeah. And it was just like a flower garden laid aside. I think there was about 32 buried, 30, I think there's 30-something. Can't remember how many there was buried that day. But John's still in that pit. Mm.
Well, you know, besides the job, besides the horror of it all, you also had tremendous poverty because it was a time of great unemployment.
Yes, you had poverty.
For all of you, short shifts, mass unemployment. What was life like for a woman? I mean, what were the women's side of it? Were they drudges? Joe, do you think that women were drudges in those days?
Well, I would think the check back on the figures itself would prove this to be absolutely true, because the tremendous amount of women that died in their 40s in those days, in the early 50s, the tremendous amount of women that died with childbirth and the kids that died with when they were being born, it's proof of this itself. I can remember a number of families in our village who were very, very hard hit with the mother being losing the mother early on.
Yeah.
One of the lads that went to school with me, actually, Charlie Hunter, he lost his mother early on, and the family, of course, all went to wreck. And Charlie eventually finished up in what we used to call at the school the Mars training ship.
Mm. Where did they get money from, though, in those days? I mean, you know, for example, Bob, you were unemployed for a very long time. How many weeks?
Our first unemployment, it lasted 6 months.
Well, what did you do? I mean, what did it feel like to be unemployed that long
of
time?
Well, it's very degrading, I'll say that. When you're working, you have that little bit of hope that things might get better next week. Like you might get extra shifting, something like that. But when you're on unemployment, it were 25 and threepence a week for me and wife and one child. There's nothing, and your hope's gone. Well, what you do, I used to maybe take that threepence and go down with lads at Green playing at marbles for pennies a time. And believe me, everybody were trying. They'd trying very hard to win for that odd penny. Mm. Well, if you won a bit, you might get sevenpence each for you and wife to go to Whist Drive at YMCA, sevenpence each. Mm-hmm. And that's what you had no social life as life is now. You had to make your own, such as cricket, football.
There were other things, Bob, weren't they, attached to those days? It wasn't only the unemployment, it was the means test, the hated means test that was brought in 1931, in which lads like myself, who were staying with their parents, and we were made unemployed. Mm-hmm. If the parent was working, only got dole for 6 weeks, and then your dole was stopped and your parents had to keep you, no matter how poor they were off. And this brought terrible things within the mining villages. It brought scores of young lads that emigrated away to Australia, New Zealand or Canada. Other lads went into the service.
It would split families up, I suppose.
Yeah. It split families up in every direction. It was a terrible thing.
Yeah. Well, how did you make ends meet? I mean, how did you manage to feed families? What sort of things did you do to
Well, when I first got married, Mick, he was getting, I think it was, he never used to get much more than £2. Sometimes he'd work, because it was short time, he'd work three shifts 1 week, and get 2 days dole. Mm. And then he'd work 2 shifts another week and get 3 days dole. But when I first fell for my first child, we'd been married about 13 months when I fell for first child. And because we dreaded having children.
Yes.
There was nothing to bring him into the world for when you looked at it. And he couldn't work. He was kept being ill. And anyway, we went on public assistance. Well, we called it parish. We used to get 15 shilling Lloyd George, what we call Lloyd George. Yeah. And then we'd get 7 and 6 from parish, but we didn't get it in money. We'd get it in a ticket. What we got to buy, margarine, jam, lard, sugar, tea. We got to spend it with what it said on that paper.
You couldn't buy a packet of fags?
Or you couldn't buy your husband a packet of cigarettes, no. Anyway, I was about 6 months on with our Teddy, my oldest boy. And I know I could have got into trouble at the time, but I didn't bother. And they came on and they said what they was getting, what pea picking was, what they was earning in pea fields, see. So I says to now, I went up to mothers, trudged up to mothers, and I took 11s in men's bumps. My feet was that big. Mm. And I says, I'm going to pea fields in the morning, man. She says, you're not. I says, I am. I says, I've not to eat in the house. She says, you're not going like that, she said. So when he rode, I got up next morning, I went. And it was the morning for me parish to come, you see. And he says to me, you'll get 6 months, you know, you'll get 6 months. I said, oh, don't talk soft, I said, it's for food for us. So when he rode, off I goes. I goes to work. I'd been out, picked 2 bags of peas, and I got a bucket full ready to bring another bag. It's true as God's my judge. And he says, I saw Mick coming. He says, you've got to come on. He says, we've had a letter. You've got to be at parish this afternoon at 2 o'clock. So I said, all right, don't worry, I'll go. So I went up to my mother's, up to Bundlow, and I borrowed one of my mother's big coats. Came home and I went. So I walked in, and it was just like going in a courthouse. So they said, you, Mrs. Brannan, I got my coat slinging, you know, and these big shoes on, because my feet were sore. So I said, you, Mrs. Brannan? I says, yes, I am, Mrs. Brannan. So I says, well, we've got this letter to say as you were working in the pea fields. I says, have you? Well, what are you going to do about it then? He says, you better go home, he says, and you'll hear about it in the morning. Well, I were worried to death, you know, it's true. So when you're over, and I didn't go early. I said, I'll wait until after everybody gets knocking on, and I'll take my mother a bottle of tea. Because we used to take it in bottles then, and took fields to them. And
were you always frightened like this?
You was. You was terrified, yes. And
of,
anyway,
of getting
when
anything extra?
Yes, you know. Was. You was. So anyway, when I picked the letter up at morning, I got a voucher for 15 shilling. So I said, well, it's done it good.
Yes, it has.
And I got a voucher for 15 shilling. Because they saw the state I was in, you see.
But what did you get up to? I mean, I know you're allowed to sort of pick coal for free and things like that. But
only in some places. That's one of the things that was on the film, you see. There was a lot of places where you're allowed to pick coal, but there was an awful lot of places where you're not allowed to pick coal.
Yes, it's true.
And many of a man in those days have been sent for 14 days imprisonment because he was caught on a tip picking coal, unemployed, and I think he heat his house, and he'd be trying to pinch it off the pit top and off the tip. Yeah. And 14 days he used to get.
Yeah. What about, I remember you telling me about keeping pigs.
Well, they used to keep a pig in bottom of the garden on scraps and all like that.
Yeah.
And then they used to have it slaughtered, and neighbours used to get it cheap off them. Like. Mm. There used to be a bloke come round who we called Pig Sticker.
Right.
You see that? This
he used to slip the old pig on this slab where he had and slit its throat. Yeah. And when we were little boys, we used to queue up for the bladder. The pig bladder.
Play football,
blow it up to play football. We couldn't afford a football. Right?
You see, you've got a great sense of humour. You're talking about these terrible things, but I think probably the thing that got you through, Bob, was it?
It had to be.
Sense of humour. Yeah. Well, in that case then, was it all misery?
No.
Did you have good times?
We did, yes.
Yeah. What do you do?
We used to, I remember at church cricket team, and in the St George's Hall, they used to have threepence you could go in and hot lads and lasses you could sit in rows and sing songs like Polly Wally Doodle and such as that. And then they'd have the old square dancing, the Alberts, just a piano and fiddle, you know, no jazz band, like, no discotheques. And if they could get a magic lantern slide with colours on, you thought you were wonderful, like. Get it corners with dark lights on and all sorts of that.
Looking back then over those years, Bob, when you look back at it
and
now,
that was
to
threatens
me,
to go in that.
Threatens.
But yeah.
But I mean, you know, is it? How do you look back at it all right now? You know,
well,
how do you feel about those days?
I know I've had a hard life and all that, but I've enjoyed my life. Mm. You know, I know things seem better. I mean, people that live there might not think so, but they really are better than what.
Yeah,
Joe, are you bitter about it all?
Oh, yes, I'm very, very bitter. I'm very, very bitter to think that the generation that I was born into should have had to endure such things in a country that was a very rich country. We're talking about a time when we were the leading...
Thank you very much, Bob Bradbury and Joe and Edna, for coming to talk to us. And that